I'm Rupert Soskin.
And I'm Michael Bott. Welcome to another Prehistory Guys interview, introducing you to people often hidden in the background, but whose work is really making a difference to our understanding of humanity in prehistory.
Today we're talking with Dr. Tom Booth from the Ancient Genomics Laboratory at the Francis Crick Institute, where he specialises in analysing ancient DNA from archaeological human remains, teasing out all manner of information from diet and disease to migrations of people in the distant past.
Tom's recent research has been shedding light on different funerary practices in the Bronze Age, revealing some fascinating discoveries about ways that people related to or looked after the remains of the departed. His work is truly fascinating, and it's really bringing some clarity to the huge genetic shifts which took place in the major transition periods of the past.
Yeah, it's remarkable how the study of ancient DNA is revealing more and more insights into the lives of our distant ancestors.
Truth be told, and not for the first time, we could have talked long enough to make half a dozen interviews. We hope you enjoy this one.
Dr. Tom Booth. Hello, Tom. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, thank you. How are you both?
Yeah, we're very good. Thanks so much for joining us. We really appreciate this. Looking forward to a very interesting conversation here. Should we just kick straight in? First question we always ask absolutely everybody, because everybody wants to know, is what is it that actually originally got you into archaeology in the first place?
So I really felt like I tumbled into archaeology, really. And to some extent into some of the subjects that we're going to be talking about now through a series of sort of fortunate things that happened. So, I mean, when I was going to go to university, I just looked at my A-levels and I was sort of interested in archaeology. It's always a cliche to mention Time Team, but from watching Time Team and things, that had always interested me. I wasn't really into it. It was just at the A-levels that I did, I thought it was a mixture of sort of more humanities and more science based. So I did sociology, history, chemistry and physics at A level. And I kind of thought, what's the best combination of these things? Because I like doing the science part, but I also like the humanities component as well. And archaeology is what turned up, really. And I wasn't necessarily all that enthused about archaeology. But then when I got to doing it at university, that was when I really got into it. And particularly the study of human remains. It always used to surprise me that other people on the course went into human remains as well, because I just assumed that everyone would be interested in human remains, but no, not everyone. No, not everyone is. I thought everyone would think it was just fun and fascinating. But it wasn't. So I just sort of went into it, and that's what I've been doing ever since. So it's that aspect. It's almost like at the time, kind of the forensic aspect of studying human remains, the idea that it's almost like a detective story, that you're piecing together parts of a person's life from their skeleton or the things that they were buried with, or on a broader scale, piecing together events or processes that happened in the past from looking at human skeletal remains.
Yeah. Any early indications when you were a kid about the way things were going to go?
I remember I used to bury my Thomas the Tank Engine a lot and then dig it up out of a flower pot.
That would do it.
There's the vivid memory of I have a vivid memory of digging up my Thomas the Tank Engine out of a flower pot, and my mum getting quite playing pop with me, as they say in Lancashire, with me when she found what they got soil all over the floor. Yeah, maybe that was an early indication. Yeah,
that's priceless. So where are you from exactly, Tom?
I'm originally from Burnley in East Lancashire. Yeah.
Cool. All right. So
good part. Well, because now you're at the Francis Crick Institute now. So what's the main focus of your work there?
So there I'm employed on a welcome-funded project in the Pontus Scogland Laboratory, so the ancient DNA laboratory at the Francis Crick Institute. And the main aim of the project there is to generate 1,000 high-quality ancient genomes from Britain. And the point of doing this is there's broadly a sort of a medical evolutionary focus in that we want to In Britain, you have this thing, the UK Biobank, which is the biggest sort of repository of genetic sequences and also other medical information in the world. And so sort of the population of Britain has become this sort of model population for looking at medical genetics, particularly because we have so much genomic information that can be linked to also, you know, MRIs and CT scans and things. So what we want to create for Britain to compare to that is this database of 1,000 high quality genomes, which we can then compare to this database like the UK Biobank. So it essentially extends something like the UK Biobank into kind of a fourth dimension. So you see the development of the genetics of Britain through time. And sort of the main aims of this project is to look at evolutionary processes, particularly so how natural selection has shaped the genome of people who have been living in Britain over the last 6,000 years or so, and sort of look at particularly as well medically relevant genetic changes. But also within that, you know, by almost as part of the process, we produce all this data on the ancestry of the people that we're looking at, their genetic sex, and figure out relationships between individuals. So at the same time, we can look at these broad questions of ancestry change in the past, as well as regional and sort of site-specific questions, again, of ancestry migration and relationships between individuals, particularly, and whether two individuals were related to each other or not, and whether they were that relationship was referenced in burial, to get an idea of how genetic relationships and were sort of recognized socially, and how that's represented in the archaeology in terms
an incredible mineable database. Then that's my understanding of what you're saying, you know, in a few words that you're developing.
Yeah, well, that's the point, is that with all genetic studies, the data is eventually all uploaded into public accessible databases. So people will keep on going back to these databases for years and years, and there'll be new discoveries. You know, we won't necessarily find everything there is to find in the data that we have. We'll look at some specific questions. Mm-hmm. But later on, people can come back and look at these things again using new look at this data again using new techniques and new methods, and potentially find things that we don't spot. I mean, there's a funny story about that my Pontus at the Crick Institute, we did one of the first study on Neolithic and Mesolithic populations from Europe, and published the results from that, suggesting that there's a significant change in ancestry in Scandinavia, at least with the introduction of Neolithic farming. And then a few years later, another research group analyzed the data that he'd produced and found evidence in one of the skeletons that he looked at that they'd suffered from plague.
Oh, my goodness.
So, okay. Yersinia pestis. So, you know, on the one hand, it's cool. On the other hand, you know, that data was just sort of sitting there. The Pontus could have found it not at any time, because maybe the techniques weren't there, but at some point he could have found it and he never did, and someone else gets swooped in and sort of found this. But there's so many other things like that that could still be, you know, lying, just waiting to be discovered, within the data itself.
It's not quite the same as discovering a significant bone lying in a dusty drawer at the basement of a university somewhere, is it? But it's amazing that new stuff can be found from... Yeah. We first came across you a few weeks ago now because of headlines about the paper in the mainstream media about a paper that you'd written with Joanna Brooke. Is that correct? Death is Not the End, Radiocarbon and Histotaphonomic Evidence for the Curation and Excarnation of Human Remains in Bronze Age Britain. But the headlines, basically the headlines were saying... Our ancestors used to hang on to their relics.
Yes. So, this was a paper. I have several hats, research hats at the moment, the ancient DNA one. And then my original, so when I did my PhD, it was looking at how archaeological bones, and particularly human bones, degrade, and how they are degraded by bacteria, and how that relates to funerary treatment in the past. And then also sort of through that, and through this project, I got into radiocarbon dating and modeling sort of radiocarbon dates. Yeah. So the point of this paper was, I think particularly it was been a long-term ambition of Joe's to look into this question, because all through the Bronze Age, and to be fair, in other prehistoric periods too, you have contexts where just bits of bones turn up, a skull here, an arm bone there, and that can be in a grave itself. So you have a grave with a complete skeleton in it, and then you might just have like a couple of bits of somebody else seemingly placed in the grave itself. So occasionally this stuff turns up in, you know, the grave fill, in which case it might be that sort of someone just disturbed another grave and then just deposited it back in to this grave they were digging for this person. But in some cases, it looks like this stuff's been placed. And similarly, in the later parts of the Bronze Age, where you have settlement evidence, you get bits and pieces of bone turning up in kind of pits and ditches and things. So this, to some extent, we know that these bones had to have been kept, or how we term it, curated for a little while, because they were disarticulated from the rest of the skeleton. So the body must have decomposed. Someone must have fetched the bone and then moved it and put it in this new context in the settlement or in a grave. The question that we wanted to mainly answer was it that kind of process that I just described? Where was it sort of an extended funerary treatment where people were just waiting for the bodies to decompose so they could get a bone and then just redeposit it straight away? Or were people actually keeping hold of bones, of human bones, for potentially long periods of time before they were eventually deposited? And the principle behind what we did, you know, is quite simple, really, because radiocarbon dating gives you the date at which the organism you're dating died, not necessarily when it was put in the ground. We looked at a lot of these examples of single human bones that look like they've been placed in particular context, and radiocarbon dated this human bone, and then radiocarbon dated something that was accompanying it, something that wasn't a human bone. It was usually an animal bone or a charred seed or something. So what you're getting is the date of the person's death, and then the earliest point at which, because we don't know whether maybe the animal bone had been kicking around for a little while, but the earliest point at which that human bone was put in the ground, and see whether there was a big difference between those two things, essentially seeing if there's a big difference between the date that person died and the date when their remains were stuck in the ground. And what we found was that there was consistently a significant offset between these bits of human bones and the materials that accompanied them, based on the radiocarbon dating. But we found that it wasn't necessarily all that long a period that things were being kept for. So we'd speculated that perhaps, you know, they could have been keeping these things for hundreds, maybe thousands of years, passed down as kind of heirlooms, and, or, you know, how you think of saintly relics today, that these were seen as remnants of sort of mythical ancestors or mythical people that lived in the very distant past. But actually, usually the maximum that they were kept for was sort of up to about 200 years, but on average they were only being kept for around 60 years or so, so maybe a couple of generations.
Okay.
In the main.
So it's more like people do nowadays, keeping the ashes in an urn on the mantelpiece, you think?
Exactly a similar kind of compulsion, that and that it was. What was important to us was that it seemed to be that there was an emphasis on people that would have lived within living or cultural memory, and they would have known who it was. It wasn't just some anonymous ancestor. It would have been someone who the people keeping the remains would have known about, and would have been able to tell stories about potentially as well. You know, would have been significant to them or sort of their close community or family. And what's interesting is the fact that it seems like that they were only buried, you know, they were after you went past those maybe two or three generations, then they were buried in the ground, which might suggest that, you know, after when this person starts to pass out of living or cultural memory, that's when they decide to sort of decommission these objects by burying them in the ground. So it does suggest that it is about, it's not so much making very deep connections with a very distant past. Yeah. In terms of keeping these human remains, it's about sort of referencing relationships between people during life or people who lived in very recent memory, I think.
Yeah.
I think one of the really fascinating finds was the thigh bone that was made into a flute. You know, I mean, because the two distinct burials that really flagged up were the woman who was buried with two other skulls. So it's like, was she buried with her parents or were they her grandparents? You know, us putting someone's ashes in an urn on a mantelpiece, there's something kind of abstract about that. But if you've actually got somebody's leg bone, that granddad's leg bone, let's make that into a flute. He used to love a bit of music. There's something quite different about the way you're engaging with your ancestry to do something, you know, play granddad's leg or it's a very different it tells us a lot about does it tell us a lot, it tells us a certain amount about how people were dealing with the deceased.
It gives us a lot of detail to play with when we're trying to drill down and trying to however hopelessly it may be, to enter some kind of mindset of what was going on.
It's just such fascinating stuff. Yeah. But an interesting thing here for me is because your specialities now, you're very rooted in modern tech. So whether it's ADNA or chemical analysis, and you've got the next generation sequencing, for example, can you tell us more about what makes this NGS, next generation sequencing, what makes it so groundbreaking in comparison with, what DNA analysis was previously?
So, I mean, a lot of it has to do with costs, but it essentially what it does is that the old methods that people use to look at, I mean, and to be fair, people still do look at DNA this way as well and still get good results, I should say, before some people that I know who use this method come and decide to tan my hide for doing them down. But these polymerase chain reaction methods is what it's referred to. And essentially what you're doing with that is that you are fishing for a particular bit of DNA that would answer the question that you want to ask. So something that's ancestrally relevant. This is the old technique. Yeah, you're essentially you put in what's called a primer, which is like if you're using a fishing analogy, like your bait, and then that sort of attracts that where you're defining what part of the genome you want to look at, and that attracts the ancient genome part of the genome to it. That part of the genome that's in there, okay. And then you just kind of fish it out and then sequence it, and then you can see sort of what version of that genetic sequence the ancient person had. So that could be relevant to their ancestry. It could be relevant to whether they could digest milk in adulthood. So you were looking at very small but very specifically informative parts of the genome. One of the big issues with this is that it was very hard to tell whether the sequence that you got back was from the ancient person or was just something that had dropped off a researcher and gotten tangled up with the bone. You know, it was essentially modern contamination. There was no way of essentially authenticating the ancient DNA sequences. What next generation sequencing does is rather than being able, well, they're fishing out these specific bits, you essentially just sequence all of the DNA sequences that are within the sample, and that includes sort of human, bacterial, sometimes pathogenic bacteria as well. So that means rather than getting these very specific sequences, you're getting millions of sequences coming, DNA sequences coming out. So you get this incredibly rich data set. And importantly with that stuff is that there are now methods to authenticate the DNA to make sure that it's ancient. I mean, there are a few ways of doing it, but it essentially relies on damage. So DNA degrades in a very specific way over time. So by looking at the ancient, the damage on the DNA strands that you get out, you can essentially authenticate the sequence and say, yeah, this is definitely ancient. So that's the main thing, is that you're getting a much richer data set in that you're getting just a random accumulation of sequences from all across the genome rather than picking out these very tiny specific parts, but also that you can authenticate the
So I get from that that huge difference is that you're getting a large database which you can throw different questions at, which you can query in different ways, not just in the narrow specific way with the as it was previously. Is that right?
Yeah. So it's, you know, you have so much information, you know, there are questions that you can ask of that. You know, you when you sequence this stuff, you can ask particular questions. I mean, there are obvious ones like, what's this person's genetic ancestry, what's their genetic sex, How similar are they to other individuals? Does that suggest that they're related or more closely related than to other populations? But there were potentially lots of other questions that could come up in the future and that we could look at through analysis, further analysis, that we can't do yet, although we haven't thought of yet, that people can go back to these
Yeah,
genomes
that's
and look at later on.
exactly what I meant.
So all of these genomes are usually on publication and made put into public databases, so people can always keep coming back and reanalyzing them. So, you know, I mean, the one thing that people seem to be working on a lot at the moment is seeing if you can figure out actual census population size in the past, because there are methods to try and figure out relative differences in population size between ancient populations, but it's confounded by a lot of different things. So there's this sort of effort at the moment to see whether you can actually figure out, sort of in terms of orders of magnitude, how big the populations at particular times were likely to have been.
That's interesting. Well, we'll watch that space. I have to ask you, this is something, this is almost a tiny detail just to throw in there. I had never heard of, before listening to one of your talks, the importance really of the Petrus bone, that it's that the Petrus bone in the skull is so resistant to contamination. Never knew that. Tell us a little bit about that.
So that, I mean, it makes sense really, because Petrus literally means stone-like, and it's the densest bone in the human body. So it makes sense that it should be so well preserved. Essentially, a lot of the other parts of the human skeleton have little porosities inside them, but this bone doesn't. It's very sort of solid, layered, and highly sort of mineralized and protective, which makes sense because it essentially surrounds the inner ear, so
Yeah, so
it must be very
it's
conserved.
this just
Yeah,
here
so
behind
your
the jaw.
temporal bone
Oh, right,
is
okay.
this bone on the side of your head, around your ear. Then the petrous portion of the temporal bone sort of surrounds your ear canal as it travels inside your skull. So it's like pyramidal shaped. So you've got your ear canal going in, and then it just surrounds it.
But
But
this
also,
is
I
your
mean,
heart, the hardest bone in your body, just here.
yeah, on the you can't touch it without putting your finger through your head. But
Okay, I'll try and
it's yeah, you can't get
Don't
to it, but
try
it's
this at home,
inside. It's
folks.
inside your head. Yeah, don't yeah. Maybe if you're yeah, like sticking your fingers in your ears, you could get far enough down to touch it. But that's the only way you get anywhere close to it. Yeah, it's like right inside your head or your inner ear. But I mean, what's interesting recently is there's in inside you probably know inside your ears you have these three tiny bones called the ear ossicles, three in each ear. And actually, they've turned out to be just as seems to be just as good for DNA as the petrous portion of the temporal bone. So I spend actually a lot of my time now fishing inside ancient people's ears to try and fetch the ear ossicles. They don't often
Of course
survive
you
because if
do.
you so a lot of time people come there, it looks like I'm just cleaning out their ears because if there's soil in there, it can sometimes trap the ear ossicles inside. So I clear all the soil out of their
Oh,
ear and they
I'd
fall out.
forgotten that about that bone.
Okay.
Yes, you did you say? I mean, it's used for establishing the gender of the body, that inner ear bone, isn't it? Am I going off on one here?
The sex, yeah, I think some measurements of that ear of the ossicles and the inside of the petrous bone sometimes, or there's a method that which it can be used to determine sex, I think. Yeah, you're thinking of, I know why, because it's Christie Willis's stuff at Stonehenge,
Yes,
yeah, the
Aubrey
shoes
Hole
and the
7.
cremation.
Yes.
Yes, exactly.
Anyway.
Yeah, so there's the internal part of the ear that's a certain shape, and it seems to correlate with biological sex.
Sorry,
But yeah, it's
slight
good that
digression there.
the
Sorry.
no, it's all right. These ossicles, I really like getting them because it's like someone's soul dropping out of their head. Because if you get that, you don't have to drill anything. You know, you can just take it, and we don't have to drill anything. We just put it straight in and process it in the lab. So if you know if we get one of those, then it's sort of a bit of a bonus really because it speeds things up and it feels less destructive as well.
So, Tom,
Fascinating.
you know, we call ourselves the prehistory guys, which, you know, sounds a bit general. But truth of the matter is, we tend to focus on the 1500 years after about 4000 BC, because that's where we started off with stones, basically, and in the Neolithic and early bronze. But you know, what has become so clear to us that it's really important to us to understand the transitions from out of the Mesolithic into the Neolithic and from the Neolithic into the Bronze Age, you know, because it wasn't so long ago. I didn't realize, I don't know about you, can't speak for you, Robert?
Robert?
We've only known each other 20 years.
Yeah. That wasn't aware of just how profound those crossover points were, those tipping points were. So we'd like to talk about that, but as a precis to that, we need to start in the Mesolithic, and that brings us to the Cheddar Man, which, as far as we can tell, is the oldest whole skeleton. Is it just in...
More or less.
Yeah.
Mostly we always have to say mostly complete. I'm sort of legally obliged to say mostly complete.
Okay.
But it's not quite complete, but it is, you know, everything before, earlier than that from Britain, is essentially, you know, like a bit of bone, apart from the Red Lady of Paviland. But again, he's not complete. He's less complete than Cheddar Man.
Yeah, yeah. But tell us about the significance of Cheddar Man in all of this.
Well, Cheddar Man was sort of sequenced as part of a project that we were looking at the transition between the Mesolithic and the Neolithic in Britain, and whether there's a genetic change suggestive that there were movements of people into Britain that were accompanied the Neolithic. So there were really very few human remains dating to the Mesolithic from Britain. It's kind of, Britain has this strange deficiency in Mesolithic human remains. And so even though Cheddar Man was discovered back in sort of over 100 years ago now,
1903,
you know, since then they're actually... I think it was 1903. I was going to say it, but then I had a crisis of confidence. In 1903, that happens a lot. Even since then, you know, after getting this sort of really important Mesolithic skeleton, there's been very little. There's been quite a few, particularly Avalyn's Hall discoveries, but that was actually before Cheddar Man, even before Cheddar Man. But other things, so there's very few Mesolithic human remains, so it was important that we looked at him. So it was kind of to get a baseline of what the populations in Mesolithic Britain looked like to compare to the ones that are here in the Neolithic. So we looked at his ancestry. He looked essentially quite boring, in that he was exactly the same genetically as other Mesolithic people from other parts of Europe that have been sequenced. He belonged to this genetic ancestry type that people refer to as the Western European hunter-gatherers. Yeah. And they essentially, from sort of the end of the Younger Dryas, so from around in Britain, from around 11,000 years ago, are the population that inhabits most of Western Europe.
And the important thing to point out is that at 8,000 BC, we were still joined onto the continent, and so Britain was a peninsula north of northwest Europe. Yeah,
exactly. And what's interesting about Cheddar Man is that he is very genetically similar to other Mesolithic people from continental Europe, so much, you know, which suggests that these places were, Britain and Europe were quite well connected, in that there wasn't much genetic differentiation between him and other people. Yeah. And when we were working on him, there was also a TV show for Channel 4 that, sort of before we started working him, just essentially wanted to do a show on Cheddar Man, and they wanted to do a facial reconstruction and inform that with the DNA. We already knew, during when we were working on Cheddar Man and working with the TV film crew, we were sort of filming some bits, and then there was a paper that came out that found that this Western hunter-gatherer population didn't have these two genetic variants that are highly associated with lighter skin pigmentation in modern Europeans. So we kind of knew that, and that essentially sort of limits how light their skin pigmentation would have been. It still is potentially a very broad range of potential skin pigmentations, but it suggests that you wouldn't expect them to have had the very pale skin pigmentation that you see in Europe, in people, certain populations live in Europe specifically. So as part of this, you know, they did this facial reconstruction, and then they wanted essentially to know quite how dark he was. So we used how dark his skin pigmentation was likely to be. So we used this forensic tool, which had been developed on whale populations that are living today, which predicted his Cheddar Man skin pigmentation with slightly more precision. I say slightly because it's not very much more precise in the grand scheme of things, but it gave a bit more precision than just it was quite dark, and sort of it fit. If you look up the Fitzpatrick, I think it's called Fitzpatrick scale of skin pigmentation, it sort of predicted that he would have had from dark to what's called in the in the classification, the dark to black skin category. Yeah. So essentially, this is a very broad range of skin pigment, which is essentially pretty much every skin pigmentation which is darker than what we see associated with Europe today. So we don't necessarily know all of the genetic variants that are associated with skin pigmentation, and there could be ones that we don't know about that influence skin pigmentation in and Cheddar Man, although it's unlikely that there are, given how overstudied European populations are and the fact that Western hunter-gatherers have a substantial genetic legacy in modern European populations, it's unlikely there's any variant in there that would substantially make his predicted skin pigmentation substantially lighter. But it's likely that him and other Western hunter-gatherers would have had sort of darker pigmentation than what we're used to seeing in Europe at the moment.
It's an incredible reconstruction, though. It's a very striking image. And there's something about it that has a sort of ring of authenticity about it. I don't know if that's the skill of the people that did the reconstruction, but also the other thing that stands out are the blue eyes. What gives with the blue eyes?
It's strange. I mean, we still don't really know why this these genetic variants that are linked to lighter coloured eyes become so prominent in Europe, particularly at this stage. There's sort of you know, it could just be that this population was what we call drifted, which is where one population splits off from another, and then just by a random chance, you know, when you sample from a population, the sort of physical characteristics in that new population, the genetics that control those physical characteristics, aren't quite the same as the ones in the same proportions as the ones that as the original source population. And then those differences through time, through this process, genetic drift, these differences become magnified. So it could be that essentially you have this Western hunter-gatherer population that split off from another population and happen to have a more a higher frequency of these genetic variants linked to lighter colored eyes. So that includes blue, green, and hazel eyes. And then over time, because they were separated from this other population, it just became essentially common amongst this particular population. But I mean, that striking combination of features is indicative of that these Western hunter-gatherers and Cheddar Man, in terms of the genetic variation, they exist outside of the modern genetic variation that we see really across the world, but particularly in Europe today. Yeah. They're kind of a population out on their own, almost what you would describe a ghost population, because they essentially don't really exist in unadmixed form. You know, all of the migrations and population changes that have occurred in Europe since Cheddar Man was alive means that, you know, the genetics of people who live in Europe today are dramatically different from those of the Western hunter-gatherers. And I feel like that strange combination of physical characteristics sort of reflects that to some extent, that his underlying genetics
I'm glad you said that, because in a world where we expect things to evolve gradually, you know, in a world of continuums, you'd expect there to be some remnant of that genome in the present day, but apparently it is not so. So,
well, it's a weird thing. So there are, so people in Britain and in Europe today do have ancestry that comes from this population, but because you have it tends to be a minority of people's overall ancestry. And it's so mixed in with lots of other things that, you know, that it's you can't really class it as being the same population. Yeah. It's sort of so transformed. But this is, you know, I'm sort of conscious talking about this stuff of too over romanticizing ancient DNA and making it DNA researchers look like they're sort of trying to reconstruct myths of people. Mm-hmm. What's important to remember about genetics is that genetics of populations are always changing. Yeah. Just sometimes they change more slowly and sometimes they change more quickly. You have these three processes: genetic drift, natural selection, and migration. All of these things, in one way or another, are changing genetics through time. Sometimes you get these periods in the Neolithic and the Bronze Age where they change in relative terms very rapidly, and you get big ancestry changes and changes in genetics. Sometimes it changes more slowly. So we people who are in Britain today are genetically different from in a more minor or more major ways than any ancient population, you know, you know, up through the sort of history. And similarly, populations in Britain who in the future will be genetically different from the ones who inhabit it today. Yeah. That's when it comes to genetics, that aspect of constant change is the norm. There is no sort of static crystallization of, it's like these are the British people. This is the crystallization of the British people at this time. That just doesn't happen in genetics. We're always changing genetically.
So talking of change, along come the farmers.
Yes.
Yeah. So. Yeah, in another paper I was involved with Natural History Museum and the Harvard University, this one I referred to earlier, looking at the genetic change over the Neolithic transition, which occurs around 4000 BC in Britain. Yeah, you see, so obviously there was a bit of a question about how this transition occurs in Britain and to what extent it involves farmers moving into Britain from continental Europe and introducing Neolithic farming practices to Britain. And what we see is that part of the issue is that we don't have many Mesolithic human remains. We have one sample that dates to the 5th millennium BC from Western Scotland.
Okay.
But that sample is genetically continuous with all the other Mesolithic samples that we have from Britain. It has no continental ancestry from the farmers that are living in continental Europe at the same time. But it's always been a big question in Britain because you have this 1,000-year gap between farming arriving in adjacent areas of continental Europe, so northern parts of northern France, and other parts of mainland continental Europe, and it arriving in Britain. So they're there, they can see Britain, but the population doesn't move over there until we don't see a change in sort of the culture in Britain so much until sort of 1,000 years afterwards.
Should we say a little bit about where they've come from in the first place before we shove them into before they get into Britain?
Yeah. So, as the Neolithic develops across all of Europe, it seems to be accompanied by quite a dramatic shift in the ancestry of the people who are living in those regions, and we can see this because the ancestry of this new ancestry that arrives is quite divergent from the ancestry that was there already, because it comes from a population who are quite have lived relatively separately from the populations of Mesolithic Europe, and this ancestry seems to originate somewhere in Anatolia and where farming practices in Western Eurasia first begin to develop, and then it seems like, and then these farming practices disperse across Europe, and with those dispersals, it seems like you get this dispersion of this dispersal of this ancestry as well, what's called early European farmer ancestry, which originates in Anatolia. And it works on a climb that the further west and the further sort of north that you go, they're sort of mixing with the local population, so you get more and more ancestry from the people who inhabited these places during the Mesolithic. But still, you know, it never becomes more than a minority component of their ancestry.
Okay.
So it's interesting in that when, the populations eventually move into Britain, so we do see a big change in ancestry. We see around 4000 BC, essentially everyone in Britain suddenly has this ancestry that over the last 2000 years comes from back in Anatolia.
Amazing.
And But also they're carrying a significant proportion, around 20-25% of ancestry from the Mesolithic populations of Europe that they've mixed with as they're moving along. So they've kind of mixed and swept. Not only do you get this sort of Anatolian ancestry coming into Britain, you also get like just this mixed sort of smorgasbord of ancestry that's been picked up from all over Mesolithic Europe that comes into Britain.
It's had 1,000 years basically to mix and diversify and everything before they're coming across the Channel, which is there by this time, by the way.
Yeah, so I mean, and now there's sort of debates. You know, it's hard to deny that there are population movements into Britain around 4000 BC. Some people would argue that there is evidence for Mesolithic people in people who were living in Britain pre 4000 BC having adopted certain aspects of Neolithic practices before then.
Yeah.
And then sort of this migration is something, or these population movements are something, you know, different and sort of slightly detached from the...
Yeah, I think Alison Sheridan might have something to say about that.
She's very strident about this. I mean, it's just too coincidental that at the same time that you get, you know, essentially what you call the Neolithic in earnest in Britain, where you definitely have these new types of these tombs, you definitely have domesticated plants and animals, that also you have this shift in ancestry, you know, pretty much at exactly the same time. It's hard not to suggest that. I mean, even if, you know, Mesolithic people in Britain did take on certain aspects of Neolithic practices that were being practiced on the continent, this point does, there's still this point where people move in, and then that is associated with a dramatic change in the culture. So, you know, in my mind, you could argue the case of there being a sort of a gradual adoption of Neolithic things in Britain by sort of Mesolithic people, but that at 4000 BC you definitely have people coming into Britain from parts of continental Europe, and that is associated, you know, times very well with the really dramatic changes in material culture and practices in Britain, sort of, and the development of the Neolithic in Britain.
Yeah.
And I think what illustrates that quite well is that, you know, in the initial period, we definitely do see some mixing in Britain, particularly in Western Scotland. There's people in Western Scotland where we can see that they have ancestors that were likely in Britain who had ancestry from people who lived in Mesolithic Britain. So there's one of their ancestors, not so far back, maybe three generations back, didn't have any of this Anatolian ancestry and were sort of genetically a Western hunter-gatherer. But by the time we get to kind of the middle to late part of the Neolithic, so about 3,500 to 3,000, if we take into account that there's been that Western hunter-gatherer ancestry that's been that the Neolithic farming populations already had, you take that into account, we hardly see any contribution from the Mesolithic people that were in Britain then. I think it's been estimated, it's even bigger. We don't make much of it in the paper, but it's an even bigger shift than what you see in the later period in the Bronze Age. You know, it's been estimated at over 95% shift in ancestry, that ancestry from Mesolithic people just is diminished, and then it never really comes back. This doesn't, I hasten to add, this doesn't translate into sort of populations being wiped out or anything like that. It could just be that in the late part of the very late Mesolithic in Britain, that Britain just wasn't that densely populated.
Yeah.
And and that you wouldn't necessarily, this doesn't have to necessarily be a what you would call a mass migration either.
No.
That you could only need to have necessarily a few groups of people moving in. But then if they are living a lifestyle which particularly farming allows you to do, where you're able to produce more children that live to adulthood and are able to have children of their own, then
supports a greater population.
Exactly. Yeah. So they could move in and just support a greater population size, and they could integrate completely in terms of intermarriage with the local populations that are there. But over the long term, genetically, they'll have a smaller genetic legacy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it is interesting how we, moving forwards, and looking at the shift of beaker culture coming into Britain, that we've had these waves coming from completely different directions, and how this vast cultural change that came with the beaker incursion. Tell us a bit about your work there.
Yes, so after you get this ancestry from, well, ultimately originating in Anatolia, predominating across most of Europe, it pretty much stays like that until around 2700 BC, when you start to see this novel ancestry coming in that is, again, divergent from the ancestry that's already in sort of parts of Central and Western Europe. And it seems to originate on the Pontic steppe, so just north of the Black Sea, and the people who were living there. And so from around 2700 BC, people who are living in central and sort of Eastern Europe, parts of Eastern Europe, suddenly have predominantly this kind of ancestry that arises on the steppe, suggesting that you're getting movements of people gradually across Europe who then mix with the local people. But for whatever reason, the ancestry from the around the steppe sort of predominates amongst these populations. And in Central and Eastern Europe, this is associated with the development of cultures that are termed the quartered ware cultures. So it looks like that these migrations influence the development of these quartered ware cultures in Eastern and Central Europe. Around the same time, you're getting the development of sort of bell beaker cultural complexes in Iberia, where it seems like that's where you get the earliest dates for bell beakers. And you see that those bell beaker cultures spread from Iberia up through and into Central Europe. But that movement of bell beaker cultures isn't associated with any genetic change. So it seems like that that wasn't accompanied by a migration. That was just sort of a movement of ideas, and that people really bought into this this bell beaker package of ideas that seemed to begin in Iberia. And these people who are living in Central Europe at the time, and parts of Northern Europe, take on aspects of these bell beaker cultures as well, again without sort of having any ancestral input from people who were living in Iberia. And they sort of develop this sort of culture that's hybridized between the derivatives of these quartered ware cultures and taking on aspects of these bell beaker cultures as well. And then when those are the sort of bell beaker cultures that we see beginning to appear in Britain from around 2500 BC. And pretty much as soon as we get these bell beaker burials and bell beaker cultures in Britain, people start to predominantly show up having this steppe ancestry. So it seems like that those people in sort of Central Europe, in areas of mainland Europe that are adjacent to Britain, moved into Britain, and they were sort of influential in introducing these sort of bell beaker cultures into Britain. And so
one thing you mentioned in one of your lectures I found interesting, I hadn't sort of really thought that way before, was that part of the bell beaker package was the emphasis on archery. And hence the significance of the Amesbury archer, who's he's dated to around about 2500 BC.
He's around then. He's one of the earlier kind of Chalcolithic burials there.
But fascinating, of course, that he's in the Stonehenge area.
Like all of these archaeological complexes, it's sort of you can speak in generalities, and then we try and get the detail. It all breaks down, but generally speaking, there seems to be a shift in emphasis, particularly in burials, to archery and wrists, well, if they are wrist guards,
the braces, get.
Exactly. And arrowheads as well that turn up in burials too.
Has any genetic work been done on the Amesbury archer? We know that the isotopes from his teeth have been done, but the genetic makeup confirms the steppe ancestry with that.
So
where is the data coming from, in other words?
So the Amesbury archer hasn't been done yet. But I know there's something on the horizon on that account, so I can't speak too much about it. But,
excellent.
But yes.
Didn't know.
Yes. We'll get you back on when that happens then.
There is potentially some DNA from the Amesbury Arch on the horizon. But there's plenty of DNA from people that lived around in the Stonehenge landscape anyway. So when we look at sort of a more regional level at this ancestry change in Britain, so, you know, over 500 years, it seems like that these movements of people into Britain result in a turnover of ancestry in Britain of about of over 90%. About 90% of the ancestry that was in Britain around between 3000 and 2500 BC is shifted by about 95%, with this mixture of steppe ancestry from the Pontic steppe mixed with the ancestry from Neolithic populations that were living in parts of Europe, or mixed together. So Beaker populations in Britain have around 50% steppe ancestry. And it's interesting in that this isn't an immediate thing necessarily. So what you see is between about the period 2500 and 2000 BC in Britain, you see a lot of people having essentially no ancestry related to the people who were living in Britain during the Neolithic. But then you get these odd individuals turning up that have actually quite a lot of ancestry. In some cases, half of their ancestry, in some cases, sort of like 25%. I mean, 25% of your ancestry suggests that, you know, there could be lots of ways of explaining it, but it's equivalent to that person having a grandparent whose ancestry was entirely derived from the Neolithic population of Britain.
Okay.
It's interesting that the one of the burials that were looked at for this paper that looked at the Beaker transition in Britain came from the quite famous Boscombe Bowman burial. This is probably one of the richest Beaker burials from Britain, and it's located on Amesbury Down, so quite close to Stonehenge. And in it, one of the primary deposits was sort of a single burial that was surrounded by disarticulated bits and pieces from. So this is actually quite a nice circle thing, going back to what we were talking about earlier about curation. Cool. Surrounded by disarticulated bits and pieces of bones from other individuals, and one of these was a skull that had been placed between this person's legs, and this genetic study included DNA from this articulated burial and this skull that had been placed between his legs, and there was a couple of interesting features about the DNA from this burial. So first of all, this single burial, this articulated burial, their ancestry, half of their ancestry looks like it was related to the populations who inhabited Britain during the Neolithic. So suggesting that one of his parents, probably his mother based on other factors, actually their ancestry was entirely derived from the Neolithic populations of Britain. And yet he's the richest burial. So there's not necessarily massive link between this ancestry that comes into Britain and these sort of high status burials. And it also indicates that through this period between about 2500 and 2000, there's probably pockets of populations with ancestry that is similar to the ancestry of people who were in Britain during the Neolithic surviving through this period. Yeah. We just don't see them archaeologically, that they are treating their dead in ways. Cremation particularly, but also potentially river burial or excarnation, leaving the body to just decompose on the outside.
And it's the burial practice is one of the most profound changes around that time, isn't it?
Exactly. And if the people that were sort of living in Britain before the sort of Beaker people arrive carried on practicing the same practices that were practicing before, we just wouldn't be able to see them so well.
Yeah.
And essentially, in the DNA, because you keep on getting these people that have quite a lot of ancestry from the British Neolithic populations of Britain from about 2500 to about 2100 BC, it suggests that that is evidence that there are pockets of these populations surviving that are sort of mixing intermittently with these groups of groups of newcomers. So that's actually evidence that you have. Oh. And you see the same thing in other parts of Europe as well, where new populations move in, that for a while you get the situation where there are two populations inhabiting potentially different landscapes and that are integrating with each other, but to a limited extent. Yes. And it's interesting, when you hit 2100, you get a little uptick in the amount of ancestry in the population as a whole that derives from, again, the Neolithic populations of Britain. So it suggests that you kind of have two populations living sort of quite in parallel and only intermarrying infrequently, and then suddenly hit 2100 and they integrate totally, because then at the same time you also stop getting people that have lots of ancestry from Neolithic Britain as well. And but for whatever reason, they have very drastically different ancestral legacies. And again, this could come back to what we're talking about with the Neolithic, because it's over hundreds of years that we're talking about. This could be because the people with this steppe ancestry have lifestyles which mean that they come in with lifestyles that means that they produce more children who live to adulthood. It could be that there's, and it's likely that there's constantly movements of populations sort of back and forth between Britain and the continent, which is constantly introducing this ancestry from Europe into Britain.
The caveat that we have to throw in, I suppose, is that we're probably talking about interactions between the elite, because that's
the burials we know about.
I'm thinking of Lara Cassidy's study in Ireland, you know, with incest in Newgrange. But the basic premise of that, you know, was establishing that high-end burials, as it were, belonged to the whatever elite, you know, and to a hierarchy in society. But going back a bit, you know, we mentioned in the Mesolithic-Neolithic transition, you said, you know, very little evidence, you know, or it's your feeling that that wasn't a case of invasion or takeover, deliberate takeover, you know, just an organic process. Do you think that's the same here? I mean, it's a big change genetically, for the population, but it seems relatively slow, and therefore words like invasion and takeover or even I said invasion, didn't I?
you did say invasion, yes.
But
those notions of aggression, we can take those out, you know.
Yeah, I think so. Invasion is, again, you know, what we're talking about when we look at the past, what we tend to, particularly prehistory, it's weird and sort of applying such a specific term as invasion to prehistory, you know, where we have no idea how they regarded themselves, territories, you know, as a people, you know, whether they had a very distinct cultural identity that would have been oppositional in that way, and that it would have been defined by territories. You know, we can't know that, and it's sort of unlikely, because that is, you know, an invasion, it conjures, ideas and events that have occurred over maybe the last 2,000 years of history. So it's sort of anachronistic in the first place, without even looking at the data. It's anachronistic to talk about invasion in these periods, I feel like. But also, I mean, there's just, you'd expect to see a lot of evidence for interpersonal violence if there was a violent takeover, and we just don't see this in the Beaker period. And it's not that, it's just that there's
interesting though.
Not that there's an absence of evidence. It's that we do see interpersonal violence, but it's lower in the Beaker period than it is in, say, like the Neolithic period.
Oh, interesting.
So you get more evidence of interpersonal violence in the Neolithic period than you do in this period. So that's the issue, is that there's just no, I would certainly, we can't dismiss it out of hand, because it feels unsavory, the idea of it being, there being violence involved, and I'm sure there were violence, but the idea of it being this mass organized takeover and invasion, you just don't have the evidence for it. We have to come up with a different approach.
But to give it some perspective, though, because, you know, we look at the data that shows that there was this almost complete changeover of gene pool, if you like, but that's based on Can we say how many samples that's based on? How many actual DNA tests? You know, so how many individuals?
It's a couple of hundred, I think.
You see that's kind of what I'm getting at. That you could have a situation here where it's a changeover of the elite, but the actual population of the country would quite possibly not change at all, of the common man, if you like. That it's the elite that we know have changed profoundly.
So the main reason, over the long term at least, that we know it's not just the elite is because when you get this introduction of steppe ancestry and this reduction of the ancestry of people who are living there in the Neolithic, it essentially doesn't come back. I've used this quite a lot, but basically, when you look at the genomes of people who live in Britain today, no one has substantially much more ancestry from Neolithic Britain than people who inhabited Britain during the Bronze Age. So essentially, right. if the common people with this Neolithic ancestry were hiding then they're still hiding now. Still hiding, and yes. they haven't integrated with the population now. So know that it is a big change, and that it is a long-lasting change, but the mechanism of that change and the period of it is still very much up in the air. And genetics can't really answer that satisfactorily. That's the issue. Is that it needs to be integrated better with the archaeology to understand what actually is happening that produces this change. You know, the genetics says that there is a change, and that it occurs over potentially 400 years or so. But it's only with the archaeology that we can really say how that happens. You know, there is no genetic variant associated with your propensity to move into Britain and kill everybody in sight. You can't look at the genetics and say this guy is a total maniac and will kill everyone, completely take over. So the genetics can't answer that question. It has to be integrated with the archaeology, and the archaeology suggests there's something much more. It is consistent with the genetic evidence. It's just not consistent with, it's consistent with a certain interpretation of the genetic evidence of potentially populations moving in into areas that are unoccupied and sort of settling down in these areas and sort of slowly integrating with local populations over time, but not so much with running in and killing everyone off.
Well, say that where are the main centers where the beaker culture first appears in? Are we talking around about in Wiltshire, general up and down the country?
There are specific regions where it's more represented. It's always hard to know whether that is because it's a genuine phenomenon, or it's because that there were a load of aristocrats who lived in Wiltshire who liked to go and dig barrows back in the late 19th and early 20th century, and so we have a big bias because I mean the barrows, you can't walk around Wiltshire without tripping over a round barrow, so they're very visible, so a lot of the evidence comes from there. But I mean, in terms of the burials from which we have the genetic evidence, yes, the earliest one is actually that skull from the the earliest one is from burial is from Dorset, Canada Farm, which is this single articulate burial underneath a barrow. Similarly, you get a few early ones as well, again, around in Wessex. But actually, another early one is up in Western Scotland as well, in a site called Fyrish. That's very early as well. So, I mean, and those are quite, obviously, quite geographically far-flung sample. So those are kind of main.
Is there any clue? Is there any idea of what the attraction was? Because as I said, it's been a long time since there was any kind of transition across the channel. Why now? Why what was the benefit? Was it pressures from internal pressures? Use of land.
There's
over
lots
populations.
Again, it's difficult to answer this without integrating it with the archaeology. I mean, there's plenty of theories out there. Some people argue that it was actually like ceremonial landscapes of things like Stonehenge that attracted some people. I mean, the obvious answer and the one that's probably has the longest legacy is, the sources of tin that you get in Britain were a big draw. And
oh, sure.
People yeah, who were, to some extent, these beaker networks were very much integrated in networks of metal exchange and potentially control of that. Of those metal resources, so yeah. That's an obvious thing, and also you have the copper mines at the Great Ormond as well. So is that aspect to it as well? Again, there doesn't seem to be, from what I know, that much, pressure pushing people. It seems people were drawn to places. There doesn't seem to be, there aren't a constant series of catastrophes that are forcing people to move further and further west.
Yeah, that's what I.
It looks like that people are moving in search of something to some extent. But again, it's difficult. There are lots of different theories as to what it is. Some
Neolithic Britain obviously had a lot to offer.
Clearly there was something that was attractive, because they seemed, once those populations arrived, they seemed to sort of be very successful.
Such a fascinating thing. I'm very conscious of the time, Tom. We're going to have to start wrapping this up, unfortunately. But tell us, so at the Crick, what's next for you? What are you working on now, and what's the near future showing for you?
Well, I mean, I'm part of I was previously part of and still involved in this project that's happening in York, actually, that I was involved with sort of just before I started at the Crick, where we're essentially doing the logical thing and from Britain moving from the Bronze Age into the Iron Age, and looking at genomes from there. So Ian Armit at York has this Commios project looking at Iron Age populations in Britain, and we've already done with Harvard University a lot of DNA from Iron Age populations in Britain, and we're going through the results for that at the moment, and that's thrown up a couple of interesting surprises. So that's going to be the future one, is that's kind of in the very immediate future, that's probably going to be the next thing, is this kind of genetics of Britain through the Middle Bronze Age and into the Iron Age. But at the Crick, because we're doing genomes from all periods, it's likely that we'll start looking in much more detail at prehistoric periods, Bronze Age, and getting, we haven't touched upon it really in this, but looking at relatives that we've identified and looking at how that relates to sort of social structure and things, but also moving, I'm vaguely hate to say this as someone who is more concerned with prehistory, into the historical periods, into looking at the Romans and early medieval periods, right. and even later to sort of figure out what, if anything, is going on in those periods too. And again, the thing is with this is that it often throws up some surprises, because, and even with the historical evidence, I expect that maybe there'll be some surprises of what we find in the genetics that maybe contrasts with what we would expect to see based on the historical record, because the historical record isn't always necessarily an accurate picture of what actually happened in terms of what's expressed through the genetics. So it'll be, that's kind of where we're going. We're essentially going all the way up to the modern day,
right?
So yeah, there could be some interesting things that are thrown up again to look at natural selection, but there could be some very interesting things that turn up with ancestry and sex and relationships between individuals as well.
Fantastic cool. stuff. Yeah,
brilliant, Tom. It's been so great talking to you. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your thoughts and knowledge, and I hope, I'm sure it will have provided a great a deeper understanding, getting that clarity of those transition periods from that we're so interested in.
Yeah, it is, and it's exciting the way all the modern tech is really helping us to unravel more of the the really hidden aspects of prehistory. So yeah, could talk all day, but there you go. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, no, I hope you can come back and talk to us another day.
Yeah, more than happy to,
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for watching this Prehistory Guys show. There's loads more to watch, and you can get to some of it on this playlist here. If you'd like to receive updates about when we publish new content, hit the subscribe button, and you can unlock even more content by becoming a Patreon supporter. Hit this button here to find out more about that. See you soon.